Chase, don't do that.
See, we're working on his brow chakra. We're just in back of the crown chakra.
All right, welcome to Waxing the Porpoise podcast. This is a show where we talk about a film my co-host has never seen before, and or a tale of the unexplained or missing cold case disappearance, kind of deep cut. Continuing the trend this week for the month of September, well, for the month of September and October, we're talking strictly horror films in preparation for All Hallows Eve, or Samhain, as it were. And this week we're covering 2002's The Mothman Prophecies, episode 22. You got your host, Jim G. Baby, and my, as always, our co-host, the usual suspect, Steve. How are you, friend?
Hello. Doing great. How are you?
I'm doing good. Doing great. Grand. Wonderful. So yeah, this is Mothman. This is one I had seen. I don't think I saw it in the theater. I think I saw it a couple years later, and I got really baked and watched it, and it fucking creeped me out. It had a lasting impression on me. Were you familiar with this at all, or had you seen it? Had you seen stuff about it and were aware of it at least, or was this totally blind Ray Charles for you?
I had heard of it.
Hold on. I might cough.
I'm gonna spill.
Dude, what's that one? I seen someone did like a TikTok of it. It was like, oh, hold me closer, Ed. And it's got, he's got the blanket on. What is that from?
I don't know.
He's like, I just don't know if my little heart could take it anymore. that's what I felt like for a second. All right, we're still recording. So okay. We're going in right to the ask if you've been familiar.
Yeah. I had heard of the movie. I knew absolutely nothing about it. I just knew it was kind of supposed to be like a spooky, supernatural thriller. But like most things, I went into it with no idea like what the plot would be or anything about it, other than just having heard of it for the last 20 years, which is crazy to think. 2002 is 20 years ago.
Yeah, dude, that's nuts. I'm coming up on my fucking, the 2023 will be my 20-year high school reunion, which is fucking pretty bonkers to think about.
Yeah, are you going to go?
I don't know. I don't think so, because we're so far away now.
Yeah. Oh, but, God. Yeah, what am I thinking? Duh. Obviously, you're not going to come all the way back.
I don't know. Maybe. I mean, stars would have to align, but I think it would be a lot of fun, because I think this one, a lot of people are actually maybe going to go to. Because the 10-year, I don't think anyone I knew went, but I don't know. Probably not with two kids and two dogs and being like 2,500 miles away. It'd probably just devolve into, have you ever seen Gross Point Blank with fucking John Cusack?
I have. It's been a long time, but I have.
It'd probably devolve into something like that, and it'd just be like, why did I do this? This is dumb.
How big was your graduating class?
Fuck, like 999 really? People. Yeah, damn. Our high school was huge. It was right before they opened up the, I think my senior year, they opened up the second high school in the town like 70,000 people. So there's only one high school besides the continuation school for the town of like 70,000 people. So yeah, we had like, I think it was like 3,800 people on campus. It was pretty fucking nuts. God, there was like, man, people every day. One of my buddies was like, I'll never see that person again. Like,
was your buddy
there was this one fuck
Yeah. Everybody a serial killer?
No, no. He just meant, you know, like, there's so many fucking people, it's like ants. No, but, like, the campus was all kind of, like, outdoor, too. Like, mm-hmm. It wasn't, like, you know, like, the prototypical you see in movies and, like, the halls and lockers and shit. Yeah. We didn't have lockers. Everything was outdoor. It felt kind of like a college campus. But I remember this one asshole, like, out of the blue, he was, like, a senior, and he dressed real nice. He wore, like, slacks and, like, button-up shirt every day. But he was, like, a closet asshole. One time he went out into the quad where they're, like, the bell rings, so all 3,600 people are, like, merging, like, ants to their next class. He went out with a soccer ball, and he just fucking booted it, like, 200,000 yards in the air. And just, it comes down, dude. It's like, you get, the target area is saturated. You're nailing someone in the dome. And it just came down and bonked some poor person. And he just, like, laughed and walked off. It's like, what the fuck? There's a lot of odd characters with that many people going around, I feel like. But anyway, probably won't go to the old high school reunion. But I still feel young at heart. It feels weird thinking that that was 20 years ago.
Oh, yeah. Another another chronicle of the old man times.
Yeah. That's funny. You've seen Gross Point Blank, though. I figured you wouldn't have seen that one.
It's been
kind of a Cusack deep cut.
Yeah, it's been a long time, but I have seen it.
So pretty much fresh eyes with Mothman we're going into here.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I don't even like to read the little descriptions on Prime or whatever, Netflix. Because then I'm such a dickhead when I watch stuff like...
You don't say.
Even, I know. Shocker, huh? even like a brief little synopsis where it's like... a disgraced cop looking for redemption searches for the killer of his daughter or whatever. Anything like that the entire time. I can't really, like, get into the lead up because I'm always looking for little things like, oh, I wonder if this is the guy that does whatever, or I wonder if this is foreshadowing for that. I'd much rather just go into it like, I don't know anything. I'm not even going to try to do that prediction thing. I was just talking to a friend of ours the other day about this boss I had who, if I would be telling him something to his face like, hey, I'm just going to run to the back and grab a new thing and I'll be right back. He would do this thing where he would look at you, and as you're speaking, he would try to mouth what you were saying, but predict what you were about to say. So if I was like, hey, I got to run to the back to grab a stack of things, his face would be like, I'm going to the back to, and it was fine. Like, he was a nice enough guy, but it was such a weird little tick that he had. That's how I am with books or movies and stuff. Any weird little detail, I'm like, I need to overly key in on this thing. You know, so I'd much rather just sit back and watch it like I'm a golden retriever and just enjoying it in the moment. So,
yeah.
Yeah, like this one I happened to catch. It's like, when his wife dies, Richard Gere looks into what happened or whatever, super brief. And then she dies and has a brain tumor. I'm like, well, I think that's pretty much that. So I don't know what he's going to investigate as far as her death. But yeah.
That's cool that they kind of use that as a beard for the description, because that's like not even like 1/16. Well, maybe a little bit more. That's like 1/10 of this movie.
Well, it seems like the connection to his wife becomes incidental rather than integral to the story.
Right. One could argue.
Well, yeah, he finds himself in the middle of this thing, and it's like, oh, shit, this has to do with my wife, instead of, like, something weird happened to my wife. I'm going to go investigate.
Right. Yeah. Well said. that's funny, the thing with the mouth that you're talking about. I don't know if it's the same thing, but my mom actually does it, and I've caught myself doing it. People have said that I do it. I guess it's more of a and I don't know if this is the same thing, but sometimes I get like overly excited, like I know what someone else is gonna say, and I'm just like my mom does it all the time. Like I see her, she's trying to like sound it out, she's like,
yeah, exactly.
It is weird when you see it. Like, when I noticed that my mom did it, I kind of internally chuckled and, like, it's funny. Like, I see now, because people are like, dude, you do this, are you the devil? You do this weird thing sometimes when you're, like, and your mouth starts, I'm like, I don't do that. That's, no. So when I saw my mom do it, I was like, oh, fuck. I can see it now.
That's funny. Yeah, it's just a weird little quirk. I mean, this guy ended up turning out to be a child molester, so I don't know what that says about you and your family, but.
Oh, fuck.
I guess we'll just leave it at that.
Yeah, that's not a good look.
No, I would agree.
Thanks,
what a controversial stand you're taking.
I feel like this is a different thing though. So going into Mothman, I guess let's cut to the chase. What'd you think of it?
Oh, I liked it. It was fun. It was spooky. I know we've talked about it before. I can't stand scary movies that just prey on, like, startling you. I much mm-hmm. prefer the kind of, like, slow psychological, the slow burn scary stuff where, I got chills watching this movie, like, five different times. Like, ugh, that's just creepy. Yes.
Yeah. That's why I think this has staying power. It's like, because when I watch it now, I know what to expect, but I still remember the first time I watched it, I liked it and why it creeped me out, you know, so I can put myself back there. But yeah, that first time, like, there are some, like, legitimate, like, points that are just, like, it's not, like, overt in your face. It's more about, you know, the whole what you can't see is more, you know, when your imagination runs wild. But also, like, some of the camera angles they use and, like, even that fucking single note piano mm-hmm. drop, kind of, it's not really a stinger like that you would use in a jump scare, but just like the way they place it kind of off key, like, uh-huh. like that stuff was like, it's super creepy. Just like the way that it's, yeah. But, yeah, I agree. This is one that's like not, it doesn't prey upon like jump scares and that kind of thing. It's like genuinely got some creepy points. Cool. So you liked it. I was thinking too. I was like, when I watched it again, I was like, I can see him because it does run a little bit long, even for me too, in a chunk of it.
The corniness Richter scale was registering a little bit towards the end.
Yeah.
But it didn't really get too high. The bridge, you know, pretty much the finale was like, all right, that you're losing me a little bit, but we've come too far, so it's fine. But yeah, I mean, even if you just thought about the premise of Mothman, I'm like, this sounds really fucking dumb, but but it was cool, and I feel like they tied it in together pretty well. And I do like anything that's sort of based loosely upon true events, even though the cynical side of me is like, well, how true are these events?
Yeah. yeah, this one's definitely like, it's a cryptid, you know, so it's up there in the same league automatically as Loch Ness, Bigfoot, the Yeti, the, you know, the Yowie, if you're in Australia. Fuck. I was searching for some Australian slang, but I don't know any really. The only one I know by osmosis is a bogan. Have you ever heard of heard anyone? He's, oh yeah, Matt, he's a proper bogan.
No.
It's like a meathead, like a cooter, or like just like a, I guess you would call him like a Chad, just like a bro that's like kind of dumb and, he's just an asshole, piece of shit, bogan. Anywho,
as a huge fan of the Crocodile Hunter growing up, I don't know if you've ever watched.
Oh yeah.
The his kid, his wife or his widow and his kids, they still run that zoo down there.
Oh yeah.
A show on Animal Planet. Dude, I fucking love that show so much.
I haven't seen that show. I'm aware. I've seen them on social media, and I'm aware that, like, the kid's grown up, and they've kind of followed in his footsteps. And I just saw something there, like, I was curious, like, how he would feel about it, because it felt a little corporate, but I guess that they built these, like, fucking high-class, like, chalets in Australia. I can't remember what it's called, like, Croc Village or some shit like that, but, I mean, the idea, like, conservation is at the core of that, and, like, it offers people, like, a chance to, like, to stay within the zoo, like, within the zoo walls, and then these really nice chalets that you can stay in, and you can see animals and shit, like, walking by, like, your fucking room, like, you're having coffee, so that's kind of cool, but, yeah, I know that they've continued to do stuff, and they've done well, but yeah, I watched the OG show. That dude was super rad. Good. Super rad dude. I've actually like to go fucking full cheese ball. I've seen a clip of him talking about his daughter and he like almost chokes up. Like, oh, yeah. But it's funny too, because he's like, what is he saying? They ask him something. He's like, oh mate, if you would have asked me when I was 25 years old, if I would have had kids, what am I doing with my future, my life? He's like, I couldn't give a rip. You know, yeah. He was like, I'm just there. I'm doing this. Bah, bah. He's like, and then he talks about, you know, when he had his daughter, he's just like, oh, mate. He's like, I can't even talk about it right now. He's like, I'm going to get choked up. Like, yeah. So I thought that was pretty cool. But yeah, he was a good dude. It sucks that he was fucking taken that way. They comedic played shit aside.
Yeah. They played a lot of those type of tear jerking clips in the episode where she's like getting married and they're just they're like, we're gonna try to make you cry as hard as we can.
Yeah,
but
step one, rolling a ball on the floor, don't cry. Cry a lot. Yeah, where did we leave off, sorry, with Moth? Just that you liked it.
Yeah, just that I liked it. We were talking about true events.
Oh, that's the point I wanted to make. I thought this was interesting in, because you know how many based on a true story, and like these were based on true events that occurred and blah, blah, blah. Like any opportunity that you would have to tie it to that, I feel like that's exploited, or like that would be used. So I thought it was interesting that this makes no mention of this is based on events that happened in Point Pleasant in 1967. Or I thought there might be at least something.
They literally say that at the very beginning of the movie.
Does it?
Yeah.
Did I completely miss that? Fuck. My bad.
It couldn't be any more at the very beginning.
Fuck.
Yeah, it's like a black screen. It's like, this is based on it. Like, literally what you just said verbatim is what the little screen said.
Remove foot from mouth. Remove pastry from
couch. Yeah. I see where they're going with this.
Okay. So you're saying there's a chance. Well, totally suicide bombed that one.
Well, you could just say like, well, yeah, but still. everything I just said notwithstanding.
point completely disregarded. So this is based on true events, but from the stuff that I looked at, because I remember when I first watched this was like 2004. Like I just watched it and I didn't like read up about it, you know? And then, so like subsequently, like, you know, I looked into the backstory and not too deeply, but, cause I consider this pretty wild, like cryptid shit. I think it's kind of like fun, like in a gee whiz kind of way, but I've never gone like deep down the rabbit hole of Bigfoot or Loch Ness or anything like as opposed to the way I have with like JFK. So when I actually looked in for this episode, they changed a ton of shit for the movie. Did you see that too? Or did you just watch the flick?
No, I mean, I didn't do a ton of deep dive research, but I did read a decent amount. And yeah, there was a lot of liberties taken, a lot of creative license, I think.
Yeah.
But it does sound like some weird shit was going on in that town. That's for sure.
Yeah. And I will say, I think the point I was driving at about the intro, I feel like for as Hollywood as they made this film, I think they could have done a lot worse. Like they could have fucked it up real bad. Even though it, like, I mean, it almost shares nothing from what actually happened outside of like sightings of the Mothman. Like everything else, like the storyline in the film, like Richard Gere, Will Patton's story, like his wife is like an amalgamation of another person and like in a fictional character. I think the same with Laura Linney's character of the sheriff, Connie. Mm-hmm. But like I said, yeah, I liked it for the story that they told. Not putting my like how accurate was this hat on. I just liked the story at face value. But yeah, it doesn't really share if you go in and or you're already familiar with Mothman and watch this. I could see someone having problems like, hey, that didn't happen that way. Or
yeah,
but.
I mean, even just like the first little really weird kind of wrinkle that happens is when he ends up in the town and like that cool little moment where he looks at the map and he's like looking for the town on the border between, you know, Maryland and Virginia or whatever. He's like, no, we're on the border of Ohio and West Virginia.
Yeah. He's like Ohio state line.
He's like, fuck, I really hope that's one of the details that is factual. It's not. I didn't see that anywhere, but
yeah,
even just something as simple as that, like, damn, that's really cool. I wish that would be real.
Yeah. Yeah. And cause what is it? It's so he leaves Washington DC at like 1 a.m. Mm-hmm. And then at around 3:30, he's on the border of Ohio and West Virginia, which is I think in the movie 400 miles.
Yeah.
In 90 minutes.
Yeah.
90-ish minutes, 2 hours.
From 1 until 2:30 is what he said.
Okay. And, yeah, that would be, and I mean, I think that's kind of related to, have you ever heard of missing time? Mm-hmm. Like in alien shit, alien abductions?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I thought that was interesting because it made me think automatically, oh, like missing time, like some alien shit going on. But, and that would be cool. I mean, but that, if that were true, that would be a way more known fact or something that people point to in like conspiracy circles, you know, like this dude traveled X amount of miles and it's like physically impossible. But I've heard, you know, like missing time, like people, like they miss like 10 minutes here, like they miss 25 minutes or, you know, like something's fucked up with their watch even too, like something stopped the motor in their watch. And so stuff like that is quote unquote has credibility on it. They're much like tighter intervals. Whereas this one, it's like, it makes you, and that's why I like having my moviegoer hat on, like right away, this one got me. Like I'm a sucker for like maps and like distances and shit like that. So like that whole angle was like, oh fuck, how did he end up there? You know, like it kind of, that's the first thing that kind of draws you in my opinion too.
Yeah. I'm the same way with maps and stuff. I actually read, my dad let me borrow, it's such a dorky thing to say, Ken Jennings wrote a book called Maphead, and it's just all about, like, it's like a memoir of a young autist and how much he loves maps, and he says that in there multiple times, but yeah, it was super boring. It took me forever to get through, like 10 pages at a time. And by the end of it, I was like, I guess I don't love maps like as much as I thought I did.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm the same way. Like it is interesting. And you were talking about missing time. We were talking before we started recording about the times that we've like drank just a little bit too much. And definitely had some missing time moments there.
Oh yeah. Dude, I remember one time that's kind of what freaked me out. Like, in my younger college era, after I had blacked out a couple times, I was like, yeah, I need to, this is not my thing. Cause I don't like that. That feeling is just so weird when people tell you what you did.
Uh huh.
And you were like fully able bodied and functioning. Like that tripped me out the first time. Like, what? I was having a conversation with this person and it like made sense. And
cause you had like alcohol poisoning one time, right?
Yeah. That was kind of like the kicker. I think I had blacked out like 2 or 3 times maybe, and then I got alcohol poisoning and blacked out. And that was
pretty bad.
That was pretty intense. Yeah, it was like, I remember it was my buddy's birthday and there was a party going on at the house, and I got him a bottle of Crown Royal, and he showed up, and I was like, all right, it's your birthday. It's like, we're taking four shots right now. And I had just gotten off work and I don't think I'd eaten since like 1 PM and it was like 10:30 maybe. Classic. And so I lined up four shots. I don't know why. Just fucking picked the number out of the sky. We're doing four shots of Crown right now. And I poured them up and we just slammed them. And I swear to God, dude, like the fourth shot, I remember shooting it, reaching in my pocket, like automatic, like a robot, grabbing out a cigarette, lighting it up. And then bam, like instant, like you're going through like a tunnel on a roller coaster ride. And then I wake up in the hospital and I have like, my shirt is ripped down the front. I have like heart monitors on my stomach and chest, and I have one shoe on and my pants. And I woke up and they were like, what'd they say? Like I blew like a 0.2 something. So pretty shitty.
Yeah.
I think it was a 0.28, I want to say. And, like a nurse came up to me and gave me like discharge paper or something, a scratch of paper. And she's like, you blew up a 0.2, whatever. That's very dangerous. You need to be careful. Off you go. Like, and then
thanks.
Yeah. There's a cab out front. I like walked. It was like, didn't break motion, like got up, grabbed that. She said that. Thank you. Sorry. I'm a piece of shit. I walked straight into the cab. It drops me off at home. And then I sat like a vegetable on the couch, like with no shirt on and one shoe, just like thinking about life and like contemplating, like having the worst, like, someone like the people like that work on railroads that like beat in a tie, like a railroad tie.
Yeah.
It was like someone doing that like every 45 seconds, like all day. I had like a almost 2-day hangover, but yeah, that was fucked up.
So what time did you wake up in the hospital? Like how much longer after that
time? I don't know, man. It could have been 10:30 a.m. or it
could really? Have been, holy shit!
It could have been like 3 p.m. I can't honestly. Oh, I can't fuck. Remember.
Because I was picturing you guys started drinking at like 10 or 11 or whatever you said, and then yeah, you're in the hospital at like 2 a.m. or something. But
no, it wasn't that late. It was definitely morning. It was definitely that is a like long. Post... Yeah,
that's a long time to be out.
Yeah.
Do you know how you got to the hospital?
One of my buddies had to go take me because I was like at the cap at the very end was I was like throwing up uncontrollably, like it was just coming out, and like and then it started to get, it looked like a little bloody.
Nice.
I think so. They were like, okay, I think I trashed his car. I had to help him clean it. Yeah, they took me there and they had to pump my stomach with charcoal.
Yeah.
To get me to stop vomiting, I guess, but. Yeah, that's definitely a low point for G-Baby. Yeah. So then, yeah, like, I wasn't, like, an alcoholic. I just kind of, like, you know, the standard college, you know, you binge drink on the weekends. And you, like, work hard, play hard kind of thing.
Sure.
And so, which is fine. Like, I can have booze and be okay. But, like, then I was, like, hard liquor, I just, it doesn't, and it was always, like, vodka and, like, whiskey, like, shitty whiskey. I remember one time I blacked out on like Canadian Mist or Black Velvet, I think. And that was one of the roughest fucking hangovers ever. Yeah. That night I blacked out. There was this big old gal that was like nursing a 40 of Old English. And I guess I walked right up to her. I snatched it out of her hand and I pounded the whole thing right in front of her face. And I was like, you were nursing that. I was like, that's not how you drink OE. And then like, me and her were like simpatico. Like I was just chatting her up. She was like my pal the rest of the night. And I was like, dude, that sounds like such an awesome memory. And I fucking nothing. So
yeah,
that kind of thing. Like I was like, yeah, no more drinking. That shit's fucked up. But yeah, like the idea of missing time and like not being in control of your body is like a fucked up notion to me.
Yeah. Well, it's like when we talked about when I had my little sleepwalking thing. The worst feeling I can think of is waking up in the morning and someone's like, do you remember what you did last night? It's like, oh yeah. God, anything could come out of your mouth right now. And I'm not prepared for it. It's scary.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm a total dirtbag. Cringe. Yeah. So, yeah, that's funny that you key in on maps and stuff. Like, I swear to God, sometimes I'll be just looking at like an area, like plan on vacationing or something, and I'll go down a rabbit hole for like, oh shit, 90 minutes just elapsed, and I was just like nerding on Google Maps, like,
yeah,
like Jesus Christ, Tokyo is huge.
Yeah, you just drop a pin in the middle of Uganda. Like, how did I get here?
Yeah,
dude. I'm also I also do it for like to try to be as efficient as possible, especially if I'm traveling somewhere for the first time. Like, because I hate being somewhere and having to rely on my GPS. Like, wait, where am I? Which direction am I going? Yeah. So before I go somewhere, especially if it's like casino related stuff, it's like, okay, I'm going to go here. I'm going to go here. I want to just get the sort of picture in my mind before I go there and not have to deal with like, let me figure out where I am and turn on my whatever. And it's just so inefficient, so you, like a waste of time for me.
You got to plot it out like an assassin.
I like to. I'm also just kind of a planner in general.
Yeah.
Like I like to overly plan. And so it's just
like, if you were older, I could see you being like Robert De Niro and Meet the Fockers. Like, you have an itinerary for the family and shit. Yeah. Like, everyone turn to page 2 of your itinerary.
That's not far off. Like, it's 8:15. We're supposed to be on our way by now. Because if we're late, then we're going to have to push back croquet and snacks.
We're supposed to have finger sandwiches and brunch. That's funny.
Jerusalem to Le Pus. Oh, you don't know shit about flowers.
There's another like weird kind of quirk in this film that it kind of teases a little bit that I'm a big sucker for, like in films and in general too. I'm curious to hear your take. So like once Richard Gere is our main character, obviously. So once he travels this fucking impossible distance, he's in like this country bumpkin West Virginia town called Point Pleasant, which is actually that's where most of these Mothman sightings happen in the late 60s. And the Silver Bridge is an actual thing and it actually collapsed. But so he finds himself there, and I don't know if we'll touch on or really try to overly synopsize this film, but like, I liked Will Patton a lot in this. He kind of bumps into him, and there's a weird thing where Will Patton's like freaked out. He's like, this is the third night in a row you've knocked at my door. Cause his fucking car breaks down. And Richard Gere's like, what the fuck? And he takes him inside his house with shotgun to his head. Like, what are you doing on my property kind of thing? So that's another additional like source of weirdness. So someone's mimicking Richard Gere for the past 2 nights. Anyway, so the cops come. The next major character is Laura Linney, or Connie, played by Laura Linney, who I think I'm a pretty big fan of. I've liked most of her stuff, namely Congo.
Yeah, Truman Show. She was really good in Truman Show.
Oh yeah, she was.
That's what jumped out to me the most.
She's also in Primal Fear, also with Richard Gere as well, which is a good flick with Edward Norton.
I have not seen that. Isn't that about a kid and a lawyer or something?
Yeah. And Catholic Church. Yeah. I think that was Edward Norton's like breakout role.
Is it anything 96. Similar to the movie Sleepers? I feel like those are sort of kind connected of. In my mind.
Yeah, they both came out the same year in 96, if I'm not mistaken. Okay.
That must be it then.
But yeah, they're also similar. They deal with like a Catholic like reformatory, I think it is, and like crooked ass guards in Sleepers. Okay. And then Primal Fear is like, this dude was like an altar boy and he was getting fucking diddled. What's that line from The Departed? He's like, over there sucking little boys' peccas.
I can't remember. It's been so long.
Dude, that part's so fucking funny. Jack Nicholson.
I need to rewatch it. It's been a long time.
Dude, yeah, The Departed's one, like, it's heavy, man. I think I've seen it twice. I watched it right when it came out, and I watched it, like, 5-6 years ago. I think that's a good one to, like, flashback to, like, every 5-plus years.
Yeah, it's got a hell of a cast.
Yeah. Dude, Mark Wahlberg. Fuck, he's so good in that one, too. I'm not a big Mark Wahlberg guy, but that movie's like tailor-made for him.
Yeah, I'm kind of, I don't know, ambivalent about him, but
me too.
Have you ever seen The Big Hit?
God, how did I forget this? I used to give you shit all the time for liking The Big Hit.
So good.
I had never seen it.
It's not it's actually a good movie, but it's super funny.
Yeah, but it's an enjoyable romp.
It is so funny. I love that movie. It's hilarious.
I remember seeing the trailer as a kid and being like, no.
The chick who they kidnap, she's doing the recording and she's like reading what they've written down, but these guys are fucking stupid, and so what they've written down doesn't make any sense. But so she's reading it literally the way they've written it, and they're getting frustrated, and she's like, you wrote this, I don't know what you want me to do, I'm reading what you wrote on the paper. It's so good. Yeah, and Mark Wahlberg's just chugging like Maalox the entire time because he's got an ulcer or something.
An ulcer?
Yeah.
Jesus. Yeah, I totally missed that one. I always conflate that one, I think, with The Way of the Gun with Benicio del Toro.
Yeah, I only remember the first like scene of that movie because it's like Sarah Silverman in the parking lot, right? And he's like, shut that bitch up or I'll come over there and fuckstart her head.
Fuckstart her head, yeah. I think that's what everyone remembers about that movie.
She's like, you like to fuck babies, you baby fucker?
Oh, man. Okay, where was I? Oh, damn, we really fucking spiraled from Laura Linney.
Yeah.
I want to say she was also in The Exorcism of Emily Rose, and I liked her in that a lot, too. But yeah, God tier Laura Linney, I think, is Congo. It's such a fucking good movie. Dude, we should cover that one, even though you've seen Congo, right?
Yeah, it's been forever. The only, I think I even said this before, the only part I remember is when she like reaches over her shoulder and pulls over like the eyeball.
Yeah. That's actually Bruce Campbell from Evil Dead.
How fun.
There's a connection. How fun. Actually, I read the book too. Michael Crichton, Congo. Yeah. Book's really good. I actually like Crichton, some of like his stuff. Like I remember weirdly like younger reading Jurassic Park. The OG, the book, and it's fucking really dope. Like it doesn't play like the movie to me. Like it's almost like more like horror. Like it's pretty intense. But Andromeda Strain and then Congo were all bangers.
I can't remember if I was just telling you this or my other buddy that I like to golf with a lot about my friend when I was growing up who used to read Michael Crichton a lot, but we were going to Christian school at the time. And so all the Michael Crichton books he would read, he would keep a Sharpie close by. And anytime there was a swear word in it, he would black it out. And even in second grade, I was like, you are such a fucking dork. Good guy, though. Shout out to Thomas. I will hold his last name back. Good kid.
Shout out to Tom.
Yeah, he was just like that perfect kid that every parent wanted. He's like, I'm going to black out all the bad words.
God. Oh, fuck. That makes me think of when I was a youth, there was some kids at the end of the cul-de-sac that like there were like legends about how nerdy they were. Like I'd only see them come out of the house like five times in 6 years. And they looked like Bill Gates's kids. And like, I guess they grew up on a computer and like books, but I remember like legend around the cul-de-sac. Like one of the people was like, yeah, they go in there and for fun, they read and they go through words in the dictionary and write down the definitions. I was like, oh fuck. Like, that's fucked up, man.
And you're just there in your mullet and Kool-Aid mustache. Like that's fucked up.
Oh fuck! That's not far off, man. I had a mullet in first grade, up to maybe even second grade.
the rare mullet / buzz flat top combo,
straight up flat top into mullet, like hard, like zero transitional space, just like hard, like perpendicular into fucking.
So for those who don't know, I always give Jim a hard time that as a kid he has this alter ego named Kevin that we haven't talked about in a while. Which, you know, Kevin would be like one of the O'Doyle brothers and Billy Madison, but when I think of when I think of your bully alter ego child, Kevin, that's what I picture. That like red haired, flat top, mullet. Yeah, Kool-Aid mustache, cut off.
I didn't have red hair. I only have a red beard.
Don't take this
from me. I was like, dude, I was like, I had a, it was probably worse this way. I was like a towhead as a kid. Like I was completely like platinum blonde until
that
like
is worse.
Ninth grade. Yeah, dude. It was like super blonde. Yeah, and then I grow up and I have dark brown hair and red facial hair.
What percentage of your childhood were you barefoot?
Not as much as you would think.
Okay.
I was actually trying to paint a picture. I was actually kind of, I wasn't that backwoods. Kind of like guilt by association, because a lot of my cousins and stuff were, but yeah, I was classified as a tenderfoot. I didn't like going barefoot very often.
Oh dude, I'm the same way. My shoes like come on when I get out of bed and they stay on.
Fucking Sambas that you have a lifetime supply of.
I've got the New Balance today.
Oh dude, yeah, I treated myself to a pair of a new New Balance, the 574s, last week. Some crispy white ones, and they are fucking comfy.
Engage,
dude, fully. No, these are like actually like show dogs, like it's got this dope like Notre Dame like outline on the end, like navy blue gold, like the back heel. I'm sneakerheading out a little bit, but they're dope. They're not the prototypical like the navy blue and fucking white dogs that you see every male 45 to 65 wearing mowing the lawn every weekend. I didn't go that far into dad mode, but I'm getting there. The shorts are starting to creep up the knee. That's how you know.
Oh man.
Notre Dame took, this is comfortable and functional.
Notre Dame took the loss this weekend. How do you feel about that?
Not well. They didn't look strong.
I thought their defense
although I will say this apologies to people who don't fucking like sports. I don't really either, but I rep Notre Dame college football, so deal with it. I thought they actually outplayed, they out-toughed Ohio State, I feel like. They just, too many mental mistakes, and yeah, they lost 21-10, I think, but they had them on the ropes 10-7 until like the end of the third quarter, so.
It was closer than the score would lead you to believe.
Yeah, for sure. Totally. That last score was just like a fucking gimme, but yeah, I'm not too tore up about it.
How much do you love the expression garbage time?
I love garbage time.
Yeah. Do you want to explain what that is for the dorks who don't like sports? Yeah.
Garbage time is like the last 2-ish minutes of a game where it actually applies to both sides. Like if you're like younger and you're like second, third, fourth string, that's the time where you're going to get playing time if you're losing. Or if you're winning too, unless you're an asshole. So if you're winning and you're beating the shit out of a team, or you're just beating them and there's no chance that they'll come back, and it's like the last 2 minutes of the game, you can pour it on. Or usually you'll bring in your, you know, second, third, fourth string on offense too. So it's like, it's the time to either run up the score, or it's also garbage time because all the scrubs are in and like this game is a foregone conclusion.
I would define it as a score when the game is already decided, it no longer matters. So if a team's winning 40,
that's
to
20, that's much more succinct and cogent than my explanation.
So if a team's winning 40-20 with a minute left and there's no chance of a comeback and they score again to go 47-27, that last touchdown, it really doesn't reflect
It's the actual just
margin of victory. It's like, oh, okay, well, the game's over, so this doesn't matter, but whatever.
Yeah. Yeah, like if we want to get real, they lost 14-10. But go, my favorite sports team, go.
Beat your opponent soundly.
Soundly. Oh, fuck. Shout out to Brian Regan.
Yeah.
That's like the one clean comedic act that I, that really like will hit my fucking tuning fork. You know, there's not many like clean acts.
Nate Bargatze's also up on that.
He's level. Awesome too.
Yeah. Yeah.
I almost feel like he could fucking, he could like eclipse that wherever he's at if he played a little bit more blue. But yeah, that's just me. Maybe he's just, he's got his niche and he's got his shit dialed, but
there is a sweet spot for clean comedians for sure. Because they can also, even if they don't make a money, make all their money from touring, clean comedians can make a shit ton of money doing like corporate events. And yeah. I've heard Nate Bargatze say like, you may have heard the expression like, oh, this person's a comedian's comedian, like Dave Attell or something mm-hmm. where it's like, oh, every comedian loves and respects this person. Nate Bargatze says he is every comedian's parents' comedian. But yeah, he's super funny.
I love his shit that he gets into, like, with his wife. There's one about, like, the airport. He's like, I don't think you could make it to the airport if the airplane was in the driveway.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, he's got his cadence and, like, he's got, like, an affectation when he talks, mm-hmm. too. I think really works for him. Yeah, he is good. Yeah, I can't think of any others. Sinbad. Dude, when Sinbad was in his prime, dude, he's got a couple specials.
Is he a clean comedian, though?
Oh, yeah. Well, I don't want to talk out of school. I know he has two clean specials that he's, like, really known for. I can't remember. What the fuck is the first one called? I think it's, like, something. And it's the one where he's wearing, like, a basketball jumpsuit. And it's, like, it's
you're gonna all have to one narrow colorway. That down.
Okay, so it's, like.
No, I don't know.
He looks like he has, like warm-ups. Like, basketball warm-ups. And they're blue. Like an electric blue and black, and it's got the swirl pattern, and it matches up with the top that he has on. It's like a windbreaker one piece that he's wearing. Sick. That special, but it's like denim. Dude, that special is so fucking good, dude. It's so good. I'll put that up there with a lot of other like blue acts. I would have to say that's at least top 10 like all time specials for me is Sinbad's when he's got that jumpsuit on.
Gaffigan runs good. Clean too. He's not my favorite, but yeah, he's one of the few I can think of who actually does clean stuff.
But yeah, Brian Regan was my first foray into like clean comedy where it's like, oh fuck, this guy actually is like funny, like bringing down the house totally clean. But
yeah,
side tangent. So where we leave off with Mothman, he's palling around with Laura Linney. That's how we got there. We started mm-hmm. with Laura Linney. Handsome woman. She starts palling around.
She's very pretty.
Yeah, she's like a classic. She's got like a classic beauty to me. Kind of ruddy complexion, kind of red. Ruddy?
What does that mean?
Like her skin doesn't look great. She's kind of pale. Ruddy.
It's kind Should of save that shot. One for the
Is it?
I don't know.
Hey, I know some people that are into that. Porcelain skin and red hair. Jessica Chastain.
Handsome woman.
I've been on a kick hearing that, so I just want to use it because I think it sounds funny. I could be completely wrong. So anyway, I thought it was funny how quick he starts palling around with her, and she's like, you know, there's been some other weird shit going on in this town too. Want to go through it? And so then he's like playing like, you know, kid detective, and there's like this montage. This is my other favorite like kind of trope is people going through files or documents of like missing shit. Like they're combing through details, like that kind of, this isn't like a true montage, but that's what they start doing. And then they start tackling like, okay, then we go into like these cases that she's talking about that are weird, like sightings of the Mothman and this and that. Is that something that you gravitate towards too? Or is that just me?
Yeah. I mean, not really in particular. One of my favorite things is, And it happens not too long after this when he goes to find the author. And he's like, hey, I need to talk to you. This is crazy. And the guy's like, go away. Leave me alone. And he's like, can I talk to you? And he's like, follow me. I'm like, wow, you really gave me that.
Yes, the find the expert, the sage shaman to help guide you through this, and God he plays damn. Gruff and then he breaks down immediately.
He wore him down pretty fucking quick.
Well, I will say, and I wrote this down too, because I remember thinking that, but to his credit, he goes out of his way. He drives, I don't know how many hundreds of miles from West Virginia to Chicago. Couple hundred miles. He drives to him the first time and is like, hey, this weird shit's happening. And then he plays the gruff. He's like, yeah, you don't know what you're dealing with. Get the fuck out of here. And then it cuts back into something else in the film. There is a pretty big segue between him coming back the second time and kind of sweating him on, like, hey, he gives him an example, like, hey, this happened. The 99 will die on to Denver on flight 9. Like, he... So I feel like there's a little bit more massaging, but he does come down pretty quick. No?
Am I
misremembering that?
I think their first interaction is when he calls him and he's like, oh, I don't really want to talk about this or whatever. But then when he shows up, he's like, hey, I called you the other day. And he's like, yeah, I don't want to talk about it. And he's like, come on. He's like, all right, follow me.
Okay.
It seems
like... Yeah, that is a trope for sure.
I love it.
And a lot of shit. There's one too, like kind of like that. And I think it's either Insidious or I think it's Sinister actually, with Ethan Hawke and Vincent D'Onofrio plays the expert. That's like, get off my lawn. Okay. I'll help you. But yeah, that's definitely a trope that sticks out. So like that other shit, I'm curious if you've seen these films too, that like, if that scratches your like weird OCD itch of seeing people going through files and shit like that, there's a really good movie. I mean, even aside of that, it's a really good fucking movie. It's called Dark Waters with Mark Ruffalo. Came out in 2018. Have you ever heard of it? Seen of it?
No.
It was like it's based on a true story, but it's like this lawyer who he represents this country bumpkin in like West Virginia, I think it is, coincidentally. Maybe Pennsylvania, but it's like it's a legal case and a fight that dragged out with DuPont for chemically poisoning like waterways and shit, developing Teflon for cookware and shit, and it like poisoned all the workers in this town. They fucking just dumped shit indiscriminately to like all the local waterways, so everyone there like cancer rate shot through the roof. And so Mark Ruffalo, he's this lawyer with like a heart of gold, like a bleeding heart fucking lawyer. Yeah. And he takes on this case and he digs into it. And dude, there's so much fucking file porn in that movie of like him going through shit and cross-referencing and like, but any, besides that, that's a really good fucking movie. And it reminds me of fucked up too.
A Civil Action with Travolta. Have you seen that?
Yeah.
Yep. Kind of similar vibe. Like
it's like that on steroids, basically.
I don't like Mark Ruffalo and I don't know why.
Dude. That's a bold statement. Watch him in Dark Waters. It might change your mind. That's one thing over the years. I'm like, dude, he's a good fucking actor. He really is, man. Like in Deep Waters or Dark Waters, he's excellent. In Spotlight with Michael Keaton have you seen that about the clergy in like Boston, Mass? Uh-uh. It was like one of the big cases in like 20. The movie came out in 2015. I can't remember what the time period is that they're covering. I think pretty close to that, maybe mid-aughts, maybe 2010s, when like the lid really got blown off fucking Catholic Church in that area, you know, like the Eastern Seaboard.
Yeah.
Getting popped and like really the most fucked up shit, and how they would like rehabilitate them and then just recycle them through the farm system of Catholic churches and shit.
The
and,
rehabilitate like, it was a
problem.
They would just relocate.
Yeah, exactly. Totally brushed it under the carpet. You know, they had their couple like scapegoats that they would try to use, but it was a rampant, like really fucked up problem that was like, yeah. Anyway, he plays a reporter in that along with Michael Keaton's excellent in it. It's called Spotlight. It's really fucking good. I think it won an Oscar, but that's one of the few.
I've heard it's good.
Yeah, one of the mainstream like consensus, like it deserved all the praise that it got, kind of thing. It really draws you in, and it's like it's the acting's really well done. It feels, I mean, it's a Hollywood movie, but it feels pretty true. Like it doesn't feel like really dressed up. But he's really good in that one too. That one changed my mind about him a lot. He plays a really good like beat reporter that's just like a dog for facts and like getting to the bottom of shit, which I love that kind of movie where someone's like trying to get to the bottom of something, like Pelican Brief with our friend Denzel and what's her face? Erin Brockovich.
Julia Roberts. I haven't seen it, but yeah, those like research montages where they're finding stuff. That is always satisfying.
The only thing missing was the fucking microfiche. I was like, oh, man. I love that. Give me a scene of microfiche, and it's like it's automatically jumped up like 5 points.
Speaking of Denzel.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so we have a new... we did it last week. It wasn't an official... segment, but now we've titled it. It's called Denzel Devotionals, where we'll play weekly a pearl of wisdom that the elder statesman Denzel Washington has dropped. This one doesn't have much like comedic value, I don't think, but I liked it a lot. So let's get into it here. All right.
And now it's time for our weekly Denzel Devotional.
In nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti.
Oh, I'm so fucking proud of that. You don't even know. No. All right, so here's our man.
Pain is passed down from father to son and son to son. A lot of pain in Troy's life is a result of the pain and the damage from his father that he then visits on his son. Sometimes it's unfair, and sometimes we take it out on those we love. And I'm guilty of that frustration that we all have. But we have a responsibility and a duty to be fathers, not to just make babies, but to be real fathers. And you can't expect any good to come to you if you don't visit any good on your son or your daughter. So be a man.
It's funny because that clip is, it's great, awesome, but the clip looks like it's on like a red carpet where he's walking by, and it'd be so funny if she's like, well, that's great and everything, but I just was asking what you're wearing, and he just goes on this long diatribe about fatherhood. Like, all right, thanks.
Like, Jesus Christ, I was just trying to get a 5 second fucking soundbite who he's wearing.
Yeah.
Tom Ford. Sorry. Yeah. That would be funny. Yeah. I love the mic drop too, because I've been watching those, I've been seeing stuff on like Instagram and TikTok, that Be a Man guy. He's like from Boston. And he's like, he just has these like 10 second little stupid like belligerent dad isms. Like one of them's like, if you're having an emergency, don't call the hospital or the ambulance. Die. Be a man.
Oh, yeah.
How that fun. Kind of shit. Yeah. Or like, if you drop an ice cube on the floor, kick it under the fridge. Be a man. yeah. So that's our new segment on, and one thing we're probably gonna have to branch out too, because I was going through and we kind of blew our wad last week, but for as much science he drops, we will reach a point where we might have to retire it. But yeah, just another nugget of wisdom from Denzel. Yeah,
I mean, it doesn't have to be a weekly recurring every time, just maybe.
Yeah, it could be like a spice that we're adding to this melange, if you will.
When we feel like the people need it the most, So a question for you.
Yes.
As the movie advances and we find out more stuff and he gets the note that his wife is going to call him. And I thought that was super cool when his wife purportedly visits the police station and is looking for him. But then he gets that note that says his wife's going to call him at noon or whatever on Friday. And then he doesn't answer the phone. Why?
I don't know. Maybe they're trying to illustrate the fear and the uncertainty. Cause like as much as he wants that to be true,
or does he know that it's not actually his wife? It's whatever this being is sort of tricking him the way it can sort of mimic people. Like when, the fire chief says that Richard Gere called him, like, well, that's obviously not him. So maybe he realizes, no, it's not my wife. It's this thing representing itself. That's my cat. That's the only thing I can think of. Otherwise, there's no reason not to answer the phone if you actually think it's your wife.
Yeah. Which is weird, too, because then later on when, like, his wife is supposedly seen by Connie, he fucking goes on, like, a mad dash to try to find her.
I think that was before.
Was it?
I think so, which was why I was confused.
So maybe at that point, like, his spirit was broken. Yeah, I think you bring up a good point. Like, maybe, like, yeah, he finally did buy into the fact, or that he just thought that it was Indrid Cold or whatever this phenomena is just fucking with him.
Yeah,
and he's not going to play into it anymore.
Because I think at that point, he had already gotten the call from... what the fuck is his name?
Indrid Cold?
Yeah, no, the dead guy from Armageddon, Will Patton, Gordon.
Oh, yeah.
And so he went out to his house and he was already dead. And so he was like, okay, well, that couldn't have been him. So this was this entity. But, you know, it seems like this entity was only actually trying to do positive things. You know, like warning. It seems like its only communication was warning people about stuff. It's not like it was like, hey, you should
slaughtering people.
You should go fly on Denver Flight 92 where everyone dies. It's like, hey, people are going to die at the equator. I was confused, but also by all the predictions were accurate, except for the one about the power plant. The catastrophe that happened had nothing to do with the power plant. It was just the bridge.
Right.
Am I dumb?
No, you're not wrong. You're just an asshole, Walter. No.
fair.
No, yeah. I mean, that's one. I guess maybe this is a good point to bring this up too. It could have just been a loose thread in the screenwriting or in the production of the film. But one, I guess, piece of trivia or a little anecdote that I found maybe that informs that a little bit is, so I was looking on the other night, I was looking up on Reddit, you know, Mothman theory or Mothman Prophecies movie theory to try to keep straight, you know, cause there's multiple Mothman theories and shit. So like specific to the movie, and it's funny, like someone asked the question, like, you know, what are your craziest theories about the Mothman Prophecies movie thing, things like that, I think was the OP's post. And funny enough, I mean, it only has 7 comments on this Reddit post, but funny enough, the first comment and the most upvoted, it was from a user called Xenochimp, and they say, I worked on the movie. This gal in this YouTube video that they're referencing is reading way too much into it. The director, what is his name? Chris Pellington? Or is it Scott? Mark. I was Samsonite. I was way off. The director, Mark Pellington, was more interested in when he could get high next most of the time. His personal assistant's sole job seemed to be making sure enough pot was available. There's so much to this movie that was completely cut. Entire characters were spent days filming were cut. We had to arrange a whole bunch of days shooting around a child actor due to rules of filming with minors. The kid isn't even in the final cut of the movie anymore. The director Pellington and the producers were constantly at each other's throats because everything was constantly taking too long and we were having a lot of overtime issues. This actually led to Pellington punching a producer over a shot the producer said wasn't needed and eventually got shot and then didn't make it into the movie. I worked on a few movies around the same time, and Mothman was definitely a disorganized mess. So I thought that was a pretty funny fucking anecdote. This dude punched a producer in the face.
Interesting.
Yeah, so maybe that's one of the threads, because that I picked up on that one too, and I just like chalked it up. Okay, well, maybe the Mothman was like in the general area of the town, but I mean, you're right. Like the previous two, like, he says Equator, but I'm not sure if he says Ecuador, and the guy's just mispronouncing it because it shows in the paper the next day, earthquake in Ecuador kills 300, and he said somewhere around the equator. In a town this size. Well, it kind of works out because I thought it was funny that Equator, the way you say it.
Do you know what Ecuador means in Spanish?
Equator?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I didn't know that.
I think so.
Nice.
If not, then I'm a real asshole.
Well, yeah, but to emphasize the point, like that, and then like the Denver, like when he told Will Patton's character, you know, he's like 99 will die, Denver 9, and then they tune into the news that day in the cafe, and it says 99 people have died on a flight to Denver, flight 9 to Denver. So, yeah, it is kind of weird that they don't made up, but yeah, I mean, yeah, one could argue, you know, that this being is not malevolent but benevolent. Because it's not out there slaughtering people. It's not fucking anyone up, except for the wrinkle in the movie that they add about the wife, because they emphasize it like she saw something and that's what caused her to lose control and like something burned through her fucking psyche or soul and she crashed. Caused the glioblastoma in her brain, or I don't know.
Actually,
that's a good point. Or, you know, it made that happen.
The brain tumor.
Yeah, that's true, actually. You're right. Okay. But it sucks because it's like, yeah, you can't do anything about that one, though. Like, you could do something potentially about the other incidents. That one's like, what can you do for glioblastoma? It's like, you've just told me of her imminent death. Whereas, like, arguably, like, with the plane and the earthquake, you could at least alert someone.
I mean, you could have done
a chance to live,
and they did do chemo, and if they got lucky, it could have killed it.
Yeah.
I mean, the earlier you get it, the better. That's for sure.
I'll meet you halfway on that one, but yeah, I mean, that is kind of an interesting through line that the thing is not, you know, trying to harm people, but alert them. I thought one of the anecdotes that that our expert character who steps in, Alexander Leak, like his analogy explaining to Richard Gere, like, why is this happening to me? And they're in Chicago, like downtown Chicago, and they have these big ass fucking skyscrapers. And he's like, you see that window washer up there? He's like, he could probably see, a car crash 4 or 5 blocks from here as it was happening, and like, or he could see before, like, this is going to happen. But to us on the ground, it's completely occluded by everything else. He's like, we wouldn't know about that. And then what's he say? He's like, just because he knows that that's coming and could tell us, like, if he had a walkie talkie, it doesn't mean he's God, or yeah, it doesn't mean that he's looking out for us. He can just see a little further down the road.
Yeah,
exactly. So that was kind of an interesting analogy that I saw in this. I can't extrapolate upon that any further. I just thought it was like an interesting way of looking at, like, trying to explain something that's unexplainable, you know?
Yeah. Well, and I think one of the probably most iconic scenes is when What's-His-Fuck calls Richard Gere and he's in the...
Chapstick.
Yeah, so... I was talking to the missus, and she's like, oh, did you watch the movie yet? I'm like, yeah, I liked it. And she's like, the only thing I remember about it was chapstick.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, interesting. And I was just thinking, like, how funny it would be to do like a sketch or something where Richard Gere like grabs his dong. And he's like, what do I got in my hand? He's like, your dick.
dong stick.
What?
Why? Do you remember that? I don't know.
Yeah.
It just hit me right. apropos of nothing, that I used to put, I had a fucking,
I still have it, dude.
This is gonna haunt your nightmares.
It was an iPod mini, I think. Yeah, I remember it.
I still have it.
Yeah, dude. So he had this little piece of shit. It was like the size of a thumb drive, little iPod mini, first gen piece of shit that when we were working together, he would put on, and for some reason, it only had one playlist, like 15 songs that would always play in the same order, and it was excruciating to listen to. And I don't know if you remember this, but I do. At one point, I jokingly offered, I will give you $30 if I can buy that from you. And you were like, yeah, for sure. And then I was like, I don't know, fuck it. This probably won't ruin my life for the next couple years. And then it did. And it just would not go away. And that song you played, the little preview, thank God. I feel like an Iraq war veteran.
Yeah, just like...
yeah.
Dude.
So bad.
I remember... What is it? The name of the song is...
The Modus Operandi.
Dude, you're going to love the name of the song. I don't think you ever heard it because it's so long. So it's a song by Isaac Hayes. It's called Hyperbolic Syllable Sesquadilimistic, and that's in the chorus when they're like hyperbolic syllabic sesquidilogistic.
God.
Bana bana bum bum.
Yeah, it's bad. It's real bad,
dude. I remember like queuing it up and then like sneaking off like 100 yards away and like peeking through a rack in a warehouse just to see like your expression or to like see your face. Cause like right when you'd hear it, like that, the fucking piano, like the fucking, like even just like that much, I knew that would spur a reaction. So I'd like hide and I'd look and sure. She'd be like, oh, it'd be like someone looking up at the sky and saying like, oh fuck. Yeah. Or like, you, yeah.
Oh my god.
I remembered that, so I had to peel a couple pieces of those to include here.
It's the worst song.
It's a terrible fucking song.
It's so bad. The modus operandi.
The modus operandi. Yes.
Oh my god.
Cerebellum. He's like listing all of the fucking bodily organs. It's such a weird song. Yeah, check out Isaac Hayes' Hyperbolic Syllabic Sesquidilogistic. It's a banger.
Or don't. Just don't.
Yeah, or save yourself. yeah, so I guess where are we at here? We got the expert trope, doesn't want to help, does he caves immediately, helps, and then he's basically another one thing I wrote down that was interesting too was like the exposition from our expert character. What's he say? He's like, cause Richard Gere describes it, he shows all like the cave paintings that his wife has made while she's in the hospital laid up, and then he sees other drawings from people in this town, Point Pleasant, who have seen Mothman and their accounts and their, you know, sketches of what this thing is that they've seen, which is this Mothman shaped, bright, glowing red eyes. Looks like a fallen angel or just, you know, like really creepy, like Mothman with these bright, beady eyes. So when he brings that up to our expert character, Alexander Leak, he says, he brings up the nocturnal butterfly in ancient cultures, the moth represents a form of the psyche or the soul immortally trapped in the hellish death realms, aka Mothman. Sightings preceding major disaster events. He goes on to explain, you know, like, because Richard Gere's like, oh, can you see it? Did you see it? What's it look like? You know, trying to get it like the surface level stuff. And then this elite character's like, well, you know, think about electricity or microwaves. You know, these are things. And like now in our age, like Wi-Fi, shit like that, you can't see, but it's going on and it's having a tangible effect. And that's when he gives like the analogy of the window washer being able to see a little further along down the road. And I thought that was kind of interesting because, you know, there's a lot of things like this day and age too that we have that would just like people's brains would explode in like the 1950s or the 60s if they're like this is what you have, kind of stuff like technology. But
yeah,
yeah, that's funny, that chapstick part. That's like that's indelibly like burned into my brain too. Is like when like the that's also a fun trope too. Of like quizzing like the cat and mouse game, and then he's quizzing like this injured cold, this manifestation of the fucking Mothman that's calling him through electrical waves, and like he's like telling him shit like to get it to grab his attention right away. He's like, what's he say? He's like, your father grew up in Monroe, Wisconsin, or
Racine. Come on,
Racine, Wisconsin. Sorry,
a league of their own.
Yeah, dude, good film. They just came out with a new series, like a reboot series.
Stay on topic.
On Amazon. Okay, sorry. I'll do that. So,
what's Tom Hanks? Who calls him a horse's ass?
Oh, dude, what's that part? No, like the no crying in baseball. He like my favorite part precedes that like iconic line where he's like you're crying. He's like, there's no crying in baseball. And he's like. Rogers Hornsby was my manager. My parents came to see me play and he called me a talking pile of pig shit. And he's like, did I cry? No, I didn't cry. No crying in baseball.
Anyway, sorry to derail you.
Yeah. So dude, oh, the iconic scene. So he's in the hotel room talking with this manifestation of the Mothman, Andrew Cold, who has creepy ass fucking robot voice. But like, he's like, yeah, your father did this. He's like, something really like abstract and esoteric. He's like, you don't remember the face of your mother. And so it like grabs Richard Gere. And then he's like, okay, this fucker thinks he knows shit. He takes off his watch and he puts it in his shoe. He's like, where's my watch? And he's like, in your shoe. And then that's when he reaches in. Richard Gere reaches in blind to like the fucking hotel nightstand.
Well, he puts it in his shoe and he goes, it's in your shoe. And then he like pushes it under the bed. And he's like,
where is it? Yeah. Dude. Yeah, that got me. I was like, oh shit. Yeah. And then he just grasps at something in the nightstand without himself not knowing what it is, and it's chapstick, and he's like, what am I holding in my hand? He's like, chapstick. And he fucking looks at it and it's like, oh shit, again. It's like boom boom.
And then there's like a book where he's like, what's page, oh, yeah, whatever line, whatever.
Yeah, he's like fumbling for the book. He's like line three, and he's like flips through, he's like on page 51, and the dude just starts rattling off like exactly what it is, and he's like, oh fuck. I guess wild tangent, I'll try to keep it quick. If you go on YouTube and you type in Mothman Prophecies, I'll add it in the show notes, theories, there's this gal that presupposes that at some point in the film, I didn't watch all of these, that the fucking Indrid Cold, the Mothman thing, grafts itself or its person onto Richard Gere. And then so from one point into the rest of the movie, he's not himself, but he's not aware of it. He's actually like one of these copies of this Indrid Cold, I think, is the way I interpreted it. Anyway, I want to extrapolate on it, but if you want to know more, that shit's out there. It's on YouTube. You can look it up. It's kind of interesting. Cause there is a flash. I don't know if you caught this. I caught this cause I've seen it a ton of times. So I was going through it with a fine tooth comb. kind of like the three quarter mark when he gets pissed off and he's in his hotel and he slams the bathroom mirror vanity. There's a couple frames. Did you see that?
Reflection. Yeah, the reflection of the little whatever.
Yeah. I didn't pick up on this like my first handful of times watching it, but this time I did. I was like, oh, fuck. And it's like this weird kind of alien like figure thing. Yeah. I think that's one of the things that she ties her analysis onto. There's a couple other things, like things that he says when he's talking that she's like this. She points at this like being him not being in control of his actions, or he's like a copy of the Mothman, whatever. But yeah, it just kind of wraps up and like going back to Laura Linney, the gal he's been palling around with, Connie, she's been having these dreams about drowning. This silver bridge collapses. That's like this main artery into town on like Christmas Eve. And it ties in with her premonition that she's been having. And it was like, wake up, 37, you're not ready or something. She gets saved by Richard Gere. He dives into the water at this bridge collapse because he has some intuition to it as well. He rescues her, and then it turns out later 36 people had died in the fucking bridge accident. So if she would have died, she would have been number 37. So it ties back to her dreams. I agree, that part definitely, like, I think they probably rushed that. That was like the Hollywood ending, like, you got to wrap this up somehow.
Yeah.
But like it was like the first example of someone taking that information, doing something about it, and being able to change the ending of what it was supposed to be. But
right.
I mean, yeah, that's really it in a nutshell. It's got some, I think we breezed over it, but I think it's a good watch that kind of, it's just like unsettling. It's a good unsettling film, yeah. And it's not overly cheeseball.
No, it's not. And it easily could be. But no, it's not. Right. I liked it a lot.
Yeah, and it's funny, like, I mean, I should probably give it a larger grain of salt than I am, that anecdote that I found on Reddit about, like, the production of this film. It sounds kind of haphazard and kind of, like, slapped together. Like, the director was just, like, fucking token up super hard every night, and there was, like, issues and fighting on set. Like, it sounds like kind of like a miracle, like it ended up as well stitched together it ended up being. Like, it could have gone fucking sideways. I've heard a lot of, like, our friend Wesley Snipes on Blade 3, I guess he was a real handful on that set, and it totally derailed the fucking production. Like, they had to, like, shoot different days. They had to work around him. I guess, like, Ryan Reynolds said that he didn't say more than, like, two words to Wesley Snipes, like, the whole shoot. He, like, barricaded himself in his, like, you know, movie star trailer and was just, like, smoking, like, copious amounts of blunts, like,
huh,
fighting with the director, like, not talking to any, not saying any words to anyone, like, for days at a time, like,
weird,
like, super prima donna, like, weird stuff going on. So to this point with Mothman, you know, it could have, the production could have ended up way worse.
That's really weird.
Yeah, I was a big fan of Blade 1 and to a lesser degree 2, but yeah, the third one is just absolute dog shit, and knowing some of the background of that is interesting because it informs, like, yeah, I can see that. I mean, they had CGI issues and, like, you know, they should have casted someone else for the main bad guy Dracula, but you can definitely tell Wesley.
I don't think I've seen any of them.
Blade Trinity. Dude, you haven't seen the first Blade is a fucking rock'em sock'em good fucking time. You would like it.
I just don't think I have.
That, yeah, I'm not arguing that, but I'm saying you should watch it. Blade 1 is dope. It's super dope. They actually have our friend Masha Hasher. How do you say his name? Masha Hasher Ali. He was the dude, the main lead in season 3, True Detective.
I haven't even watched season 2.
Oh, God, we are lost. Skip season two and watch season three immediately. There's actually a fun coincidental tie back with Blade One and the upcoming Blade reboot with Masha Hashar Ali is Stephen Dorff was in the original Blade, and then he also played Masha Hashar Ali's partner in True Detective season three. Real star turn, like a revival role for Stephen Dorff. He kind of faded into obscurity for a lot of years, but I will argue that his performance in True Detective season three is fucking stellar. Like season three of you liked season one of True Detective, right?
Yeah. I thought it was a little oversold. Yeah.
I don't know how I feel about that.
Well, digest it. Cause I just heard nothing but good stuff all day,
and it didn't hit you that way?
No.
Oh, man. You're a tough sell sometimes, I tell you what.
Sometimes. I try not to be.
Yeah.
But.
No, that's fine. I really struggle with, like, not being, like hooked into, you know? But at any rate, True Detective Season 3 is fucking awesome. You know, season two is fine, whatever. People him and haw about it. It's very divisive. It's a self-contained story, so you can skip it completely. If anything, season three actually towards the end, it actually ties back in very subtly to season one, but it's not contingent on watching either of the two previous seasons. And it's definitely a totally different vibe than season one. It's doing its own thing, but it's very good. And at any rate, the lead in that, Masha Hashar Ali, is starring in the Blade reboot in the MCU in the next 1 to 2 years, I think, which I think he'd be a good Blade, but I'm pretty butthurt that they're rating it, I think, PG-13. And to me, that's a fucking huge red flag and a huge mistake, because the OG Blade with Wesley is rated R and it's fucking dope. So
I'll get don't off my care. Fucking,
I'll get off my Blade soapbox, but
you said,
dude, that's one of his most iconic lines when he says he's some motherfuckers always trying to ice skate uphill.
I stopped listening when you said MCU. So
okay. Well, so the first Blade is not within the MCU, if that makes any difference. It's like its own thing, and it's rated R too, so
it does. Yeah,
it's rad. Anyway, all right, so yeah, I think this is gonna wrap up old Mothman Prophecies. I don't know, I don't think this really fits the vibe too much of like getting into Halloween. I mean, I would argue that way. Maybe a September watch, because it's definitely creepy. It's got some weird shit going on, but there's really kind of like the previous film we watched, Christine, there's no real tie to like Halloween. There's no pumpkin sightings, I believe. so it's not like it's not intrinsically Halloween-y, but it'll get you revved up perchance. So, question, were you a big Pete and Pete guy? Did you ever watch Pete and Pete?
Yeah.
Do you remember the Halloween special Halloweenies?
No.
Pete and Pete? Oh, no. Dude.
How do you remember it?
I don't remember it. I didn't watch Pete and Pete growing up because I felt like it was always like at a weird time. And like it was like one of those weird shows on like Nickelodeon that I just never got into.
It was no Salute Your Shorts, but
Donkey Lips. Yeah, they have a really good special called Halloweenies. I recommend it. It's super good. It actually has one of the guys from, I think his name's Rick Gomez from Band of Brothers, who plays a really cool character. It's like an early role for him, so it's got a little added kind of fun factor, like seeing him in like an early role, but it's very fun. It's very, will get you in the mood for like Like carving a jack-o'-lantern. Trick-or-treating. Yeah. Pete and Pete. Dude, did you ever watch Ghost Rider? Was on PBS?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Dude.
I did. I could only ever watch it at my grandma's house.
Dude, that's so weird you fucking said that. I was just talking about this with some other people, too, because I had found out they rebooted it in, like, 2019, and it's on Apple TV, and they're coming out with season 3 in, like, 2 weeks. It was, like, the first season of the reboot was, like, highly acclaimed, won all these fucking awards, but I remember it being on, like, between, like, circa, like, 1992 to, like, 96, maybe. Somewhere in that era. And then they, it was in syndication also, but I remember watching it at my grandma's house because she had a TV guide and we didn't. And it was really hard to pin down because sometimes it was on at like, it was like one of those shows that started on a 5, like 2:35 instead of shit used to always come on at like a 30 or the hour mark. And it was like an hour long or it was a half hour long. I remember reading the TV guide specifically. It was like 4:55 on a Thursday afternoon. They would play Ghost Rider, or like 2:35 in the AM on a Sunday night on PBS. They would play Ghost Rider in syndication, but it's like a little ghostie that would come around and help them with words and shit and solve a mystery. Like,
yeah.
Sherlock Holmes style.
I must've watched it long after it was live because it would have been like late '90s and it was just on like one of my grandma's weird satellite channels. But I fucking love that show.
That was a good show, man.
It was good. Yeah.
Yeah, they fucking rebooted it in 2019. I just, because I have kids too, it's easy to get, like, reinsert yourself into that kind of stuff and try to do the whole live vicariously thing. So we watched some of the new shit. It's pretty good.
Is it?
Yeah. I like it a lot. I mean, my tastes have changed since having kids. So like, and then also like having like an Insta family with shacking up with my wife. It's like, she had a niece and nephew when I met them, they were like 8 and 6. So they were kind of into that shit. So I kind of got into like, you know, R.L. Stine's Haunting Hour was something he did after Goosebumps. And there's all these like anthology shows, like Are You Afraid of the Dark? And, Goosebumps that have come out since like in the early 2000s and late 2000s and stuff that I've watched and I can appreciate now being an old piece of shit. So yeah, I don't know, man. Now like it's like Halloween didn't, I used to like it, but now Halloween's like my favorite holiday by far. Like this whole like going into fall, like I think it ties too to like the season changing and finally getting away from heat. And so I associate that with like cooler weather, fucking crisp fall morning, leaves changing, falling, raking, football, scary Foosball. Shit, pumpkins.
He wants a pumpkin.
He wants a pumpkin. Oh yeah, update on the garden. I have 2 pumpkins growing right now and they're looking pretty dope. Dude, I didn't tell you this. My fucking pumpkin patch, it started growing up. There's this little tree right next to it. It started growing up in the fucking tree and like vining like crazy. So now I have a pumpkin tree. How dope is that?
Anyway, this was a fun one. I think we should probably wrap this up.
Anyway. Good times. Anytown, USA, Jerry. Yep, that'll do it for us. No new reviews. If you want to if you want to shoot us a rating or a review, we'd be welcomed. You can reach out to us directly if you have any comments about Mothman or anything else. Wax at waxingtheporpoise.com, or you can reach out to us on our socials. Instagram is Waxing the Porpoise. Twitter is @waxingtheporp. Shit. What do we got next week?
Do you want to just figure it out later?
Yeah, we can do it later.
Oh, you're such a fucking bitch.
I can't remember. I think we're doing a Scout's Guide to the Apocalypse, which is a really fun one from 2015.
Sounds dumb.
It does, but dude, I watched it and I about laughed my nutsack off. Like, I remember there's a point I laughed so hard in a recliner, I almost shot backwards. In like I it ejected myself, and I'm really curious to see, because Kelsey fucking she's a pretty tough crowd sometimes, dude, and she fucking laughed her balls off too. So I was like, dude, this
what's
is
it, what's
this
it is called
A Scout's Guide to the Apocalypse. It sounds really dumb. It's really well made. It's fucking, it's really funny. It's the only thing I can think close to it is like a non-British Shaun of the Dead. Okay. Have you ever seen Shaun of the Dead?
No.
Oh, Jesus. We really are lost. So that means nothing to you, but I think people listening,
I know what it is,
who are familiar, but would agree.
Somebody is going to take that thing and stuff it right up your ass.
Yeah. So The Scout's Guide, it's a zombie flick, but it's got heart and it's really fucking funny. I thought it's become like a yearly watch for sure. So
okay. Well, I mean, you've got a pretty good batting average so far. So
yeah, I'm surprised. So I'm confident this one's going to keep it going for sure. So yeah. Anywho's, thanks for joining us. Again, this has been Mothman Prophecies. Check us out next week. Hit us up on socials. And in the meantime, if I don't see you, I'll see you. What is it?
What? If I don't see you tonight, it's good afternoon, good evening, and tomorrow. Or some shit. I don't know.
No, that's Truman Show.
I thought that's what you're... Laura Linney. No.
I'm blitzed. I'm thinking of Kenyon's thing. I'll see you. Oh, that's what it is. I'll see you when I'll see you, and I'll see you later.
Nice.
All right. Man.